Okay, so I made a mistake. Give me a break. I miscounted. I'm really good at miscounting. The number of episodes on the good list, and Harry Mudd is an extra, so he goes on the bad list. Talk a little bit about Mudd's women, and then we'll get on with the real stuff. Mudd's women. Here's Harry Mudd as the peddler of flesh, and of course the Hubba Hubba episode from our boys.
At base, the story is about the ephemeral quality of beauty, in that the women believe that they are only beautiful when they take the drug that Harry gives them. By the end, well, it was how you felt inside that made you beautiful.
I tried to categorize the episodes into different themes. So here's a description of which one they are, and you'll see that they're kind of spread around. In other words, it's not a whole sequence of one theme. I wanted to be able to give the audience that feeling that each episode was a new story. First up is Where No Man Has Gone Before. This is the second pilot. The first one was a Menagerie and wasn't all that well received. This one has a better story than The Cage, really. It's a godlike power corrupting one character who is then threatened by another. And the little people, that's us, caught between them. Second one to introduce characters is Galileo 7, with concentration on Spock, McCoy, and Scott. So we get to see them interact. We get to see Spock as the intellect, McCoy as the motor. Kirk is still the synthesizer. And Scotty knows how to do stuff. So that gives us a look at the entire of Trinity or the Quadrinergy, whatever. The Trinity of characters, and add one for Scott, who knows how to... Captain, the engine cannot stand the strain, that guy. The third of the character introductions is the Naked Tongue. Captain's log. Now this gives us a look at some of the minor characters, Sulu and Uhura specifically, and something of what goes on below the bridge. So this is our third introduction that introduces some minor characters. It also introduces the ship as a specific character. And so that's the third and last of our introductions. So now we see the dynamics of our whole crew under stress. So we see that they are level-headed and active.
Sorry, neither.
So now we have to show people what we can do. So first up is Charlie X, a story of an adolescent who acts as sort of an avatar for all of us as we go through adolescence. He can act out his violent urges and do anything. So if the power of an adolescent is made manifest, then there's no limit to what they'll do. And that's a danger. This puts the audience on notice that this is not another Lost in Space. This is serious stories with serious consequences. Number five is Balance of Terror. This term comes from a description of a nuclear strategy from the days in the 60s between Russia and the United States. The idea is that we are both so terrified of the other that we won't attack them, that a first strike will be followed by a retaliatory strike, and so nobody wins and everybody dies. That's the balance of terror.
Our reflection no longer follows us.
This also has a duel between the two captains, specifically. And they are both caught in a situation where one of them has to die. This is an echo of a movie called The Enemy Below.
All right, let's go get it.
Yes, sir.
All engines ahead, full ring up 18 knots. Then you see.
I do not see how we could have missed at that range.
We shouldn't have. I think this American captain is no amateur.
Well, neither am I.
There is one foolishness, and that's the everybody has to whisper in a spaceship surrounded by vacuum, or the bad guys will hear it. That comes straight out of a submarine situation. That's silly, but everything else leads us to a situation where not only does one have to die, but one has to kill himself rather than be captured. This is a story of two ships who are theoretically at odds, each one having to try and destroy the other. Now, number six is Shore Leave, which you might not think is a good idea, but it's a frivolous episode. It's a be careful what you wish for story, pretty much literally. It's an outright fantasy show, and it shows us that we have a wide canvas of things we can tell stories of. It's not just war and battle and go here, go there, fight somebody. It's a fantasy. It's a signal that we're not always deadly serious. Shore Leave was the fifth episode broadcast, and it's pretty much where the prepared scripts ran out. The story had to be rewritten on the fly. Gene Roddenberry was famously sitting under a tree rewriting the episode while they were shooting. So here's where the episodes become just whatever's ready to shoot. And that's why in the original broadcast order, there isn't any kind of pattern. There isn't any kind of pattern to what's being done. It's just, oh, this one's ready, let's go.
Don't breathe. Don't think. You're at attention.
Next up, A Taste of Armageddon. Now, this is, again, a commentary on the Cold War in the 1960s, where both sides could engage in what's called a nuclear exchange, where both sides essentially obliterate the other.
Casualties among our civilian population. Total.
This goes back to Balance of Terror again, but it's a different face of it. Every so often in the 60s and 70s, somebody would come up with an alternative to this Balance of Terror, this gun to each of our heads situation. Here's one that tries to evade this issue by simply killing each other in great big bunches, but not destroying each other. It's not a very good solution, but it is a solution. This shows us that there really isn't any substitute for just stopping a nuclear arms race. There are no good solutions except stepping down from trying to kill each other. There is no good alternative to simply stop threatening to blow each other off the face of the map. Having been alive during that time, it kind of made you uneasy. Next one, Dagger of the Mind. Now, Dagger of the Mind is a mind control episode. This is based on, at the time, rumors of research by both Russia and the United States into mind control to try to make assassins, unknowing assassins. But the idea was that each side would have agents that didn't know they were agents, but were programmed to kill somebody. This showed up in a movie with Charles Bronson called Telephone. Check it out. It's a good movie. So the mind control would be by hypnotism and mind-altering drugs. The CIA had a fairly famous program that was an utter failure called MK Ultra, which didn't become known until the 1970s. But this shows again where the show can go. The show can go from apocalyptic things to personal things. So our canvas is growing and growing and growing. This Side of Paradise has the theme of being tranquilized to be happy. The seeds not only make you happy, they make you not strive. They make you no longer willing to strive to do anything beyond be happy. This is a bad idea. If we are always happy, we have no existence. As one of the characters at the end says, we haven't done anything.
Get out of your mind.
Why are we here? Why do I exist?
I didn't want to, Jim.
If I'm just blindly happy, is that enough? And the answer is no. No, it's not. It takes Kirk to not only discover this effect, but to undo it, starting with Spock, who is the last person you would expect to be mindlessly happy. But there you are. So This Side of Paradise is another canvas-building thing by taking on essentially a philosophical as opposed to military or conflict situation. Here is a story that has no outside threat, except that everyone will be seduced by the happiness that the spores give and why that's a dead end.
Couldn't pronounce.
Number 10 is Tomorrow is Yesterday. This is time travel that starts out as a serious issue and then is eventually turned into comedy. This, again, is another canvas grower. Now we can do not only war and personal issues, we can do time travel. We can do an outright science fiction-y thing. It winds up being a comedy of sorts. It plays fast and loose with causality and other things by just sort of waving their hands and saying, no problem, we'll just transport them back to where they were right before they saw us. And we won't be there, except, of course, if we're going back in time. We would be there. Let's just wave our hands and say, no.
I am going to lock you up for 200 years.
That ought to be just about right.
I had to put the menagerie in here somewhere, so I figure it's episode 11 and 12. This story is cribbed from a Twilight Zone episode, People Are Alike All Over, in which humans are imprisoned in a zoo, and that's exactly what happens here. But the twist is that what appears to be a cruelty is actually for eventually both the Pike and the lady is a kindness. So that's a nice twist. And it also puts a different spin on aliens. Now they're not necessarily good or bad. They're just working for their own motives, which turn out to be not necessarily malevolent. Menagerie was made because they had run out of scripts again. And so they shot a few things, went into the editing bay, and cobbled together two episodes out of a slightly longer than an hour pilot. It's a sign of how hand-to-mouth Roddenberry had made the stories for the show. And it would have been way better if he had scripts in hand before the show begins. A lot of shows today don't have those, but they should. They should have things in the pipeline. But Roddenberry had no pipeline at all. It was, this is good enough, shoot this. To follow the menagerie, we have Space Seed. This is the Khan one. It's a story of what happens if a master race exists, how they feel about us, and how we feel about them. This is a hark back to the Germans in World War II, which, when this was made, was only 20 years in the past. So it was still fresh in pretty much every adult's mind, one way or another. And so they have the same revulsion of a master race that Kirk and the crew of the Enterprise does. And the master race is so arrogant that they believe that they have the right to do the things that they do. So that's a story of the threat of believing yourself to be some form of master race, either physically, intellectually, or even morally. It's a matter of the arrogance of knowing you're right.
Have you ever read Milton, Captain?
The statement Lucifer made when he fell into the pit. It is better to rule in hell than serve in heaven.
The next one is the Corvomite Maneuver. That's a first contact situation in which both sides lie about who they are and what they can do. So both sides lie about how important they are, how strong they are, and also how well the bridge crew, and by extension the entire crew of the Enterprise, can stand up to this you're going to die in 20 minutes pressure. And as we see, one of the crew really does freak out. But only one, and he returns after having recovered his sanity. And in the end, of course, we discover that the alien, is not particularly dangerous, and is just seeing what will come from this interaction. The result is Tranya. Next up is The Return of the Archons. This is a story, again, about mind control. This is, instead of being happy, everyone is just unemotional. They just exist. And they exist to be kept in steady state. They exist to not be violent, to not be anything. So there's another one like This Side of Paradise, but with a slightly different twist in that once a year, everybody's allowed to go crazy, absolutely crazy. And rape and pillage and we don't see it, but presumably murder as well, to blow off steam from being controlled so thoroughly the rest of the year.
Help me, help me, help me, help me, help me.
In Errand of Mercy, the next episode I'd have, it's another East-West War episode, except it's not outright conflict between the humans and the Klingons, but it's what they used to call a brushfire war. It's a little bitty attempt by each side to obtain the resources and presumably the cooperation of an unaligned planet.
I am Spock.
The planet is on neither side, and both the Klingons and the Federation want to make use of it as a base with or without the permission of the locals. And this mirrors part of the U.S.-Russia Cold War in that each side would try and nibble around each other's asset. So you can look at Korea or the Belgian Congo, Iran or Vietnam or Cuba or Haiti as an attempt by one or the other side to subvert their opponent. And so this Errand of Mercy shows that sometimes the children have to be shown that they're being children. And that's what the locals show them. That this is ridiculous, and here's why. You are playing with things that you don't understand and can't possibly defeat. 17, Devil in the Dark. This is another canvas expanding. By the end of season one, we expect to have shown the audience that there are very few limits on the stories we can tell. That's sort of classic science fiction. The limits don't exist. The world is not the only border. Devil in the Dark is a story of what if we find life that we don't even recognize as life? That is, we don't recognize the threat of this life that we don't recognize. And so in our ignorance, we become endangered. This theme showed up a lot in The Next Generation, not as well, in my opinion. But we've expanded our range now. And this is really a parable about racism. In other words, people who are racist don't recognize the humanity of some other group. And here, the Horta is the other group, and we don't recognize their ability to think or to act or indeed to be mothers and children with any conscious thought of what that is. And unfortunately, it has the rather embarrassing pain, oh pain, that one from Spock. But it's the way it goes. Number 18 is Operation Annihilate. Now, this is probably the worst of the episodes that I have kept. And it's basically a steal of Heinlein's The Puppet Masters. But if you're going to steal from Heinlein. It's stealing from the best. Roddenberry claimed afterwards to be critiquing Heinlein's technocratic and very ordered societies that he foresaw. But having read Heinlein, I'm not sure Roddenberry actually read any Heinlein. That ordered society just doesn't exist in Heinlein's stories. By the way, The Puppet Masters was published in 1951. So if you think that Heinlein might have stolen from Roddenberry, no. Heinlein, by the way, won 4 Hugo Awards for Best Novel. That's the most of anybody ever. This also invents another, gee, that was lucky, with the Spock's extra eyelids, it just wasn't necessary. It could have been that Spock was blind and it came back. I mean, as people who go blind, sometimes the sight just comes back. So they didn't have to, wave their hands and say, oh, an extra pair of eyelids. And no, that's ridiculous. We've never heard of it before. We never hear of it again. So, no. Next one up is another comedy. We're switching back and forth. We're basically being very dramatic. And then every once in a while, we'll come up with something that's funny. We see this in the television show Supernatural, where some episodes are just flat frivolous. We even saw it in Teen Titans, the animated Teen Titans, where a comedy show was signaled by the theme song being sung in Japanese. So The Squire of Gothos is Charlie X as a comedy. There's another break from the dramatic. Again, with the alien being determined to be not just dangerous, but a dangerous child who must be disciplined not by our heroes, but by his parents, who turn up at the end and save the day. But we're showing the audience that you can't depend on anything. This isn't like Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea, where every week it's a giant octopus, or in Lost in Space, it's always danger, Will Robin. That, okay. An unlimited canvas to tell stories on. It's very important for the audience to get that impression, because it'll keep them coming back. All right, we're in the home stretch now. Next up is Miri. In Miri, we see the possibility of biological warfare. Now, this was, again, a theme of the 1960s and 70s, where the possibility of one side or the other infecting the other with some sort of lethal plague. And rather than destroy the enemy's entire civilization, you just kill all the people. And then you can move in. And whatever the problem with the biological war is that, of course, the biological agent will get out. We saw that in the Stephen King, The Stand, in which a plague killed 99.936 of everybody. And what happened after that? We see that in The Omega Man, where everybody has been killed or turned into a vampire except our hero. That's the way it appears at the beginning. So Miri is not only a biological warfare situation, it's also a biological warfare situation that will kill everybody eventually. It also says that we can develop things that we don't quite understand, and they may be really terrible. You might remember that the plague in Miri was originally a life extension bacteria, which turned out to kill everybody who had adult hormones. So as the children grow up, they die too. So this is a parable not only of biological war, but of advancing technology without thinking about it too hard. We're down to two episodes now, and the last two, and we want to leave people with a hunger to see more, to come back next season and see more.
Is this supposed to be a good thing, Mary?
So first one is Court Martial. This is a really good episode right up until the end, where Kirk goes, where they use Kirk voiceover to advance the plot. Beatman sobbing, blah, blah, blah. That, okay? Except for that, if they had done it a different way, for instance, if Kirk had found Finney and just told him, we know what you did, and then Finney exploded and said, I love the service more than anyone ever dared, and just collapsed. That would have been, in my opinion, a better end. And it would have been about the same distance. You wouldn't need the big fight, because that's one of the problems with Star Trek and other things, is that they seem to want to have a big fight at the end, where all of the moral issues are settled with fists or knives or swords or phasers or whatever. So we could have made this more of a downbeat ending, which would have still told a story of someone who's been passed over unjustly and how that colors their entire life. You know, there are people who fixate on some event and say, this is why my life didn't turn out the way I wanted. And so we see Finney, we see one of these people, and we see how they come to explode. And also the idea of the trial at all, the whole thing about books was kind of silly, but you have to go back and think about the law as the law, not just what you think it might be, but what it really is. So that's an important thing to say too. The last one, as you might expect, is City on the Edge of Forever. Now, this story is stolen by Harlan Ellison, don't tell him I said this, from Ray Bradbury's 1952 Sound of Thunder, in which a man steps on a butterfly back in dinosaur days and changes the whole of history, so that when they come back from dinosaur times, things are changed in ways that are not necessarily for the best. But Ellison takes it a little bit further, where he says, what happens if you go back in time, change something, and it makes you impossible? McCoy goes through the Guardian, and all of a sudden, the Enterprise disappears. And the reason that Kirk and all the rest don't disappear is because they're next to the Guardian of Forever. If they hadn't been, they'd have been gone too. So now they have to go back in time and undo whatever McCoy did or would have done. This is a common theme in television nowadays. Pretty much everybody's done a time travel episode at some point. But up until then, it really had only shown up in Outer Limits and Twilight Zone and things like that, where the boundaries, like Star Trek, the boundaries were very wide. On either of those two shows, you could go anywhere and do anything. Ellison sends us back. Not only do we have to change the past, but we get to know the person who has to die. We get to know that Edith Keeler is a good person, that she doesn't deserve to die, but she has to, or else everything will change, everything. One flaw in the episode, though, is when McCoy's phaser is found by the hobo, and he sets it off and phasers himself and the phaser itself. Now, that takes care of the phaser being found, but we know that killing somebody who doesn't necessarily deserve it changes the future. Well, that hobo just died, didn't he? Who am I to second-guess Harlan Ellison? By the way, there's a story that Harlan Ellison wanted in his story to kill Scotty. He wanted Scotty to be killed in the episode because he thought this would show that anybody could die at any time. This is a common theme in more recent dramas. Nobody is safe, and therefore you have to worry about everybody. But Gene Roddenberry wouldn't do it. He said, look, I need those characters. These are the central characters. You can't kill one. And Ellison took great umbrage at this, that someone was telling him what to write and how to write it. But he got over it, apparently. But City on the Edge of Forever is a very well thought out episode anyway. It takes a lot of the ideas of time travel and causality and how fragile the time stream is. You can't tweak it. You can't change it. Because everything changes, especially the further away you get from the event. That's a pretty cool way to end the first season, is on that intellectual an episode. The idea is that now people will look forward to season two because they can see who all the main characters are. They can get it. They have an idea of how they react in situations of stress. They know what kind of trouble they can get into. They know the means available to them. So now we have a complete story set up. And also a lot of good stories. So, am I right? Am I wrong? Have I wasted your time? Have I wasted my time? If you've gotten all the way to the end of this, I thank you for listening. Next up, unsurprisingly, season two.
I am endeavoring, man, to construct a mnemonic memory circuit using stone knives and bearskins.
Bye-bye.
Your pulse is 242. Your blood pressure is practically non-existent. Assuming you call that green stuff in your veins blood.
The readings are perfectly normal for me, Doctor, thank you. And as for my anatomy being different from yours, I am delighted.